Thanks to all the audience who follows our broadcast. We are about to start our second conference on the first day of the 2020 International Web-Based Neurosurgery Congress. Remember, we are streaming on YouTube Live too. Well, we have the honor today of having Dr. Atul Goyal. Dr. Goyal is a world-renowned school-based neurosurgeon, chair and professor of the neurosurgery department of King Edward Memorial Hospital in Mumbai, India, and chief neurosurgeon at Tata Memorial Hospital and Cancer Research Institute in Parel, Mumbai, India. Right now at the IWBNC, Dr. Goyal is going to share the lecture, Designing Surgical Strategy for Complex Brain Tumors. Please type write your questions in the Q&A section. We will read them after the end of Dr. Goyal's presentation. Welcome, Dr. Goyal, and thank you. It's all yours.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Colombia. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon to everybody. Good afternoon, good morning to young neurosurgeons, to old neurosurgeons, and to everyone. And we discuss our life of complex neurosurgery, our life of complex brain tumors. Most important is that we have to understand the tumors. By our experience, more we operate, more we understand, and complex can become less complex or maybe easy. So these are my books, which I had written in 1996, Neurosurgery of Complex Tumors and Vascular Lesions. You see my exposure, carotid artery displays, Gasserian ganglion displays, facial nerve displays, vitrectomy done. So this was my exposure in 1996. And many of you know my work on craniovertebral junction and spine. First, I want to talk to you about cavernous sinus. And you must read some of my beautiful papers where I mention that cavernous sinus is not just a venous space. It has got great functions, big functions. It controls the eyes. It controls the eye movements. It controls and regulates the eye health. It regulates the pituitary gland. It regulates the body temperature. It regulates the cerebral blood flow. It regulates and connects the temperature of the brain with the temperature of the exterior. So many things. So these are just speculations, and I am giving you some references I wish that you read. So cavernous sinus has huge function. Cavernous sinus is located behind the eyeball. There is vitreous humor, there is aqueous humor, there is lens. And this whole eyeball is a miracle, is an absolute divine structure of hydrodynamics. And this hydrodynamics of the eyeball, which controls the retinal function, is regulated by the cavernous sinus. Cavernous sinus is indeed a huge structure. Like we know about the circle of Willis, similarly, there is a circle of venous connection, intercavernous connection. There is a circle of relief. I like to call it circle of relief. So when you press one eyeball like this, the pressure goes on the other eye and there is some diplopia for some time and the whole system balances. So these intercavernous sinuses are very important structures. So when there is venous thrombosis, the eyeball can stop functioning, eye movements can stop functioning, vision can go. Even when the optic nerve is present, the eye, the extraocular nerves are present. So venous presence of veins of the cavernous sinus has a huge role to play. Of course, to know more about my thoughts, you must read my articles. So cavernous sinus has a role in eye movements and also has a role independently in the vision. So when a deer runs, his eyeballs are laterally placed, lateral. Lion eyeball is in front. So when the deer runs, it has to see how far is the lion coming to catch the deer and how far it has to jump. So it has to see in front, it has to see in behind, and the eyeball moves like that very rapidly. And because the eyeball moves rapidly, the cavernous sinus in a deer is much bigger than a cavernous sinus of a lion, where the lion has to just look in front and attack the deer. So location, the function is very important to determine the size. So what I call is structural innovations. Functional necessity determines the functional, the structural innovations by God. The eyeball of a fish is laterally located and the cavernous sinus has much more fat content in the cavernous sinus of a fish. Even humans have some fat content, but fish has much more fat content. And the cavernous sinus has much bigger role in fish because it not only has a role in eye movements, but it also has a role in swimming, in balance. Like we do Romberg signs, we close the eye, the person, you know, loses balance. So balance is one of the function of eyeballs in a fish, and it helps in survival of the fish. So there are beautiful eyes of various animals, including humans. And the size of the cavernous sinus is determined by the size or by the nature of the function of the eyes. So this is cavernous sinus. You see, it is located by the side of the pituitary gland, by the side of the paranasal sinuses. The information about the external temperature goes to the cavernous sinus, and cavernous sinus then relays the information to the pituitary gland. Cavernous sinus also gets the information from the carotid artery. So pituitary function, which is the master organ, is determined by cavernous sinus. So we must understand cavernous sinus. So when the air goes in our nose, it can be hot or cold outside. But when it goes in the paranasal sinus, it moves in the turbinates, it becomes normalized. The mucosa of the paranasal sinus is the most vascular structure of the body. So this vascular structure gets the information about external temperature, gives the information to the cavernous sinus. Similarly, oral mucosa is the most vascular structure. When we drink hot fluid or cold fluid, the temperature remains hot or cold in the mouth, but when it goes in the esophagus, it becomes normal temperature. So this mucosa, the most vascular structure of the body, has a great role to play in the temperature regulation and various other things. I like to call it air conditioner of the body. Another thing I want to talk about is the meninges are the mother of brain. Meninges come first, brain comes later, and bones come last. So this sentence I have got from Arabic legacy, Alum al-Dimag. So this is a very important sentence, and I will relay my presentation on this concept. That dura, which covers the brain, is durable. Dura is impermeable. Dura cannot be transgressed. Even the tumors do not transgress dura. So this concept I'm going to introduce to you today as far as the tumors are concerned. No question that all of us who want to do complex surgery, we must understand the anatomy has to be perfect. Anatomy of the complex areas or anatomy of the normal areas, and anatomy when there is a tumor. So tumor changes the anatomy. We must try to understand that anatomy. So there are several articles of mine as to how the tumors of the cavernous sinus have a meningeal relationship, how they are related to the meninges, and how we can design our concepts of surgery on the basis of the meningeal architecture. So these are very old papers. These are 20 years ago. These are written, this is 22 or 23 years ago. And these are some papers which you will like to read. This is another very important article which I had written in 1998, where I said that carotid artery can determine the pathological nature of the tumor. When the carotid artery is encased, it is different tumor. When carotid artery is encased and squeezed, it is different tumor. When carotid artery is displaced, it is different tumor. So these pictures are from this article, which you must, this was a very important article at that time, because before MRI, we were not able to identify the carotid artery. We were able to see the tumor with CT scan, but carotid artery and its relationship was delineated by MRI. And that is how our complex neurosurgical arena started. And we started to do more complex skull-based tumors. So my advantage is I work in a public institution, and for several years I have been able to do very complex skull-based surgery. Most important thing is this was done 27 or 28 years ago. You can see the relationship of this tumor with the basilar artery, with the carotid artery, and how I removed this tumor in 1993, and this patient continues to be alive even today. So what we have to do is we have to have experience in breaking the tumor, experience in demolishing the tumor, experience in handling the bleeding, experience in dissecting the subarachnoid spaces, experience in protecting the vessels, experience in dissecting the blood vessels and in a proper plane. And more important, we have to learn, because if we damage any single blood vessel or nerve, we can create a big morbidity. So this was another tumor in 1995 I operated, going in the orbit, going in the cavernous sinus, and going everywhere. This is another tumor in 1995. There is small residue. At that time, we didn't have radiation. Of course, I will not give radiation even today for this residual tumor, because I have a feeling that we have to learn how to operate. We have to learn how to break and demolish the tumor. Radiation will come only when we say that, oh, I cannot operate and I cannot break the tumor. So this was another tumor 23 years ago I operated, and you can imagine the complexity, particularly at that time. And this person is also alive for several years. To see how the cavernous sinus is involved, how the posterior circulation is involved. So these are difficult problems, but when we come into neurosurgery, we have to learn how to handle difficulties and how to handle complex problems. And we have to learn how these complex problems will behave. So this is another retroorbital, very difficult tumor to operate, cavernous sinus. So this has two tumors and both are in difficult situation. And I operated this tumor, which was a vascular tumor. As you can see, first I removed the orbital tumor, then I removed the cavernous sinus tumor. Both tumors benign, and this patient is alive even today with complete no tumor recurrence. So we can give new life, we can give new vision, and we can give absolutely wondrous life to the patient and to the relative if we understand these problems. So in 1997, I described for the first time extradural approach to tumors involving tumors. You see, we know about Vinko Dolan's work. He described aneurysms and extradural approach, but this was the first time intracavernous sinus, not trigeminal neuroma, intracavernous sinus by an extradural approach we described in 1997. So first tumor that I want to discuss is cavernous hemangioma. These are the most benign tumors, most vascular tumors, and these are the most difficult neurosurgical problems. They remain within the confines of the cavernous sinus. What we have to learn in this tumor is that they will bleed, and they will furiously bleed. These are not pituitary tumors. These are not meningiomas. And they have a very defined pattern. They are intracavernous sinus, and they respect the dura. This is the lateral wall of the dura. This is the tumor goes towards the orbit, towards the Meckel cave, and towards the intercavernous sinus, towards the cella. So this part of the tumor is intercavernous sinus dura. It encases the carotid artery. So this is one tumor which encases the carotid artery. And that is what we have to, you know, when there is tumor is vascular, it bleeds, and also carotid artery. So we have to be very, very good in understanding. So these tumors are intracavernous sinus and they respect the dura. So this I removed in 1991. At that time, such tumors, not many tumors, had been removed in the literature, cavernous hemangioma of the cavernous sinus. And these are relatively rare. So even when the tumor becomes huge, like this, you see it goes towards the intercavernous sinus, goes towards the orbit, goes towards the Meckel cave, lateral dural wall will remain intact. So if you understand that the dura is going to be intact here, you can design a surgical strategy. And carotid arteries encased, despite the huge vascularity, these tumors angiographically, they are relatively occult. So most important is they are benign tumors, they respect the dura, you remove the tumor and you can give new life to the patient. So we describe, because this is cavernous sinus, because cavernous sinus is an extradural entity, I described extradural approach to cavernous hemangiomas in the year 2000. So 21 years ago, we described that these tumors remain within the dura. You come extradurally and then you resect the tumor. And then you have to, of course, save the carotid artery. Most important thing that you have to save is the sixth nerve. So recently we described that the sixth nerve is displaced on the inferior border of the tumor. The cavernous lateral wall of the cavernous sinus, the fifth nerve, the third and fourth nerves are located lateral on the lateral wall of the tumor, never inside the tumor. So this concept that the third nerve, fourth nerve, fifth nerve will be lateral, sixth nerve will be inferior, carotid will be here, you can do an extradural approach to remove this tumor. So this is one patient who came with the third nerve and sixth nerve, and I removed this tumor in the year 2000. So I will rapidly show you this video. Of course, this is a very old video, 21 years old. So I'm going to just show you extradural approach. You see, I'm approaching I'm elevating the dura of the middle. This is anterior, this is posterior. The tape is not so good, but you will see this is the foramen rotundum, this is the foramen ovale, and I'm doing extradural. Most important part of my surgical technique is minimum coagulation or no coagulation. Even in the most vascular tumor, you can remove with minimum coagulation. And the other important thing in my technique that you will see is the bipolar will come very infrequently. Now you see the fifth nerve is exposed, the whole Gasserian ganglion is exposed, and I will try to enter. You see lateral, the fifth nerve is laterally displaced. So we have to understand the fifth nerve is, so this is V2, this is V1, and I have first worked within the V2 and V1. Now I am working above V1. So this is Parkinson triangle. You see the very vascular tumor. You must know that this tumor is the most vascular tumor in neurosurgery, but they are also very benign. So first I am identifying the tumor. Then the most important thing that I have to identify is the sixth nerve. So within the red blood that you are seeing, you see the sixth nerve I have identified very early in the operation. And then I will remove the tumor. So these tumors are relatively rare. I have got the largest experience in the world of more than, not more, it is actually 45 or 46 cases of these tumors. So once you remove this tumor, you see the anatomy in very great, beautiful anatomy. More important thing is, you see this patient had eye vision problem, and now there is eyes have come back to normal within 2 months of surgery. And also you see there was no smile on her face. Now there is a big smile on her face. So because these patients come with the symptom of headache, and the headache is the most difficult symptom, that main symptom that you can have. This is another tumor I will quickly like to show you where I did an extradural approach. You see, I have elevated the dura, and I am coming. This is the Gasserian ganglion, which is displaced. And I will now open, I will split the Gasserian ganglion. You see here, I'm splitting the Gasserian ganglion and going inside the cavernous sinus. So the first thing that I will like to identify is the sixth nerve, and then this vascular tumor I will remove. Most important is there is no need to heavily coagulate. You try to demolish the tumor. You learn the art of breaking the tumor. You see there is carotid artery you can see inside the tumor. You learn the art of breaking the tumor, learn the art of operating in a bleeding area. And I can say that this tumor, which I'm showing you, is almost an unedited tape. So many of these tumors have been removed within 20 minutes or 30 minutes. If you go on operating these tumors for 10 hours or 15 hours, you will lose a lot of blood because these are vascular problems. So once you remove the tumor, the bleeding will be stopped. These tumors are supplied by the inferior trunk of the inferior lateral trunk of the carotid artery. You see, this is if you see carefully, there is this artery, which is the main supply of the tumor, which the only thing I will coagulate. And once I coagulate, the bleeding stops. And what bleeds is the venous blood of the cavernous sinus. So if you want to operate on cavernous sinus, you cannot say I will have a bloodless field and I will operate only when there is no blood and all those things. If you have that kind of attitude, you cannot operate on cavernous sinus because cavernous sinus will bleed, and many of the tumors or most of the tumors in the cavernous sinus are benign tumors. And if you remove, you cure the person, you have to operate over the carotid artery. Sixth nerve is inferior. Sixth nerve is displaced on the inferior pole of the tumor. So you operate over the carotid artery loop. So that is the way you have to remove this tumor. And you see this tumor I have removed in 10 minutes. And you can do a good, beautiful resection. Most important thing is you have to save the sixth nerve. And that forms the very important part of this operation. So this is preoperative and this is postoperative. As I mentioned, I have operated about 45 or 46 of these cases, which is the largest number in the world. So this is another cavernous hemangioma. You see it is encasing the carotid artery. Lateral wall is intact, goes towards the intercavernous sinus. There is an aneurysm here. I operated this patient 25 years ago, and this was the tumor which was resected and the aneurysm was clipped. So these are rare kind of problem, like an AVM, which is flow related aneurysm, heavy bleeding. So you can have this problem. This is another tumor, cavernous hemangioma. You see it is going towards the opposite cavernous sinus. Lateral wall is intact. It is a benign tumor, extra dural. So dura, this tumor respects the dura, and you should respect the dura during surgery. An extradural approach is beautiful. Next tumor, I want to show about pituitary tumors and how they respect the dura. And this is my several articles on this subject. And this giant pituitary tumor I had written about 20 years ago, this article, and of course, several other articles that you are seeing here and you can read if you have time. So pituitary tumors can become very big like you see here. And they can become very big, and there can be cystic and fluid-filled cyst in these tumors, but they are benign. Even when they are giant or large, they are benign. So you must remember that no matter how big they become, pituitary tumors essentially are low-grade tumors, and we have to remove them radically, because if you can remove this radically, you can give new life. So we designed a classification, and we introduced a beautiful concept. For the first time in the literature, we said that when the pituitary tumor becomes large, it elevates the dura. It elevates the dura on the dome of the tumor. It does not transgress the dura. It lifts the dura. So that concept that the dura is going to be elevated by the tumor is completely revolutionized pituitary tumor surgery. So these tumors do not go supracellar through the hole in the diaphragm cellae. They elevate the dura. So this respect of the dura we describe for the first time in the literature. So the dura is elevated. So if you understand the dura is elevated, you can remove this tumor from the nose. So this dural relationship of the pituitary tumor is very important. So this dura, even when there is a nubbin of tumor here, diaphragm cellae, this domain is under the dura of the diaphragm cellae. So there is dura. So we have to know that even when the tumor becomes big like this, the dura remains intact. And if you have this information, you can remove this tumor because the dura protects you from the intracranial structures. And if you do not have this concept, you cannot remove these tumors. If you think that this tumor will encase the arteries of circle of Willis, you cannot remove this tumor. You have to have a very clear concept that the dura is going to be present. So even when the tumor is going like that inside the brainstem, it is not that it is transgressing the dura. It is not transgressing the dura. It is the dura is intact and you will never find an artery inside the tumor. Grade 2 tumors I call when the tumor enters into cavernous sinus and encases the carotid artery. Lateral dural wall remains intact. The diaphragm cell dura remains intact. The lateral dural wall remains intact. These are grade 2 when it enters the cavernous sinus. When it enters both the cavernous sinus, the diaphragm cell dura is intact. The dura is intact. The dura is intact. So these tumors are grade 2 tumors when the tumor is on both sides of the carotid artery. You see this tumor, beautiful tumor. You see the diaphragm cell is elevated. The dura is intact. The dura is intact. Carotid artery is encased. So I call these tumors grade 2 tumors. So here, this is another tumor. The diaphragm cell is stretched. The lateral wall is stretched, but not transgressed. I call it dura mater or dura mother. So this mother is not transgressed. The benign tumors respect the mother. So that concept has to be there. If you have this concept, you can remove these tumors. So dura is intact, grade 2 tumor. Now you carefully see this tumor. The diaphragm cell dura is there. There is a lump here. So this is not. This is also elevation of the roof of the cavernous sinus dura, dural elevation. So this we described for the first time in literature that this tumor is subdural or intracavernous. And when this dome of the dura of the roof of cavernous sinus is elevated, we call these tumors as grade 3 tumors. So now you see there is elevation of dural dome of the roof of the cavernous sinus. Here in this tumor, there is elevation of diaphragm cell, elevation of the dura of the roof of the cavernous sinus. So this tumor also respects the mother dura. And accordingly, we have to design our surgical strategy. So you see here, very beautifully seen, this is the dome of the diaphragm. And this is the elevation of the dura of the roof of cavernous sinus. So this anatomical understanding is absolutely critical if we have to operate on these tumors. So you see quite a haphazard kind of presentation, but no, there is a method in this madness. Elevation of the dural roof of cavernous sinus, elevation of diaphragm, elevation of dural roof of cavernous sinus. There is a pattern, this trifoliate pattern of extension. And if you understand this pattern of extension, you can design your surgical strategy. Grade 4 tumors are those where the diaphragm is transgressed and the circle of Willis arteries are encased. So these tumors which do not respect the mother dura, I call them malignant tumors or aggressive tumors. And these tumors are a little different from the regular pituitary tumors, but these are not very common. So this was my classification. Grade 1 is when the diaphragm cell is elevated. The tumor does not enter into cavernous sinus. Grade 2 is when the diaphragm is elevated, the tumor enters into cavernous sinus. Grade 3 is when there is elevation of the dural roof of the cavernous sinus. Grade 4 is when there is encasement of the arteries of circle of Willis. So I have no doubt in my mind that this understanding of the dura has completely revolutionized pituitary tumor surgery. It is very flimsy to say I use microscope to remove or I use endoscope to remove. More important is to say that I understand the dura and I can remove this tumor without violating the dura. So that is a very important article of mine that you must try to read. So this tumor, you see here, normally when there is a tumor we have to know that you just break the anterior wall of the cella, enter the tumor, learn the art of demolishing the tumor, breaking the tumor. These are essentially soft tumors. And you can remove this tumor in 20 minutes or 15 minutes. And if you are going to remove this tumor in 5 hours, you do not know how to remove this tumor. There is no need for coagulation inside this tumor. Break the tumor, break the tumor, break the tumor, demolish the tumor, demolish the tumor. There will be bleeding, but ultimately the whole diaphragm will come and you will get this picture and patient will improve in the vision in the immediate post-operative period. I removed this tumor in 1997. Most important is that we have to understand that the pregnancy, the uterus is a strong muscle and the only way to deliver the child is transvaginal. No elephant or horse or any other animal is delivered by cesarean section. This is a human fantasy that we try to transgress the body membranes. There is no need to do cesarean section because uterus is the strongest muscle of the human body. Similarly, the diaphragm is very strong. Like a pregnant lady, you break into, get the tumor. Many of these tumors or most of these tumors are soft. Break the tumor, break the tumor, break the tumor. And within 10 minutes or 15 minutes, the whole diaphragm will come into picture and you have cured the person. These are benign tumors. Vision will improve instantly. And this is another tumor you can see. And there are several tumors in my list where we have done more than 5,000 pituitary tumors. You see, this subfrontal extension was a very common indication for transcranial root during that time. You can imagine 25 years ago, most of these tumors were removed by transcranial root. But believe me, there is no need to do transcranial and there is no need to open the planus sphenoidal or tuberculum cellae, open the dura here, learn the art of breaking the tumor, demolishing the tumor, and the diaphragm will eventually come into picture and you will remove this tumor. This tumor was removed in very quick time. This tumor, another tumor, you see how it is going, but you should know that there is diaphragm here. I just removed the anterior wall of the cella, broke into the tumor, demolished, and ultimately this is some fat lying here in the immediate post-operative period. This another tumor I removed 20 years ago. You see how it was going. And with the concept, and I tell you this, young people listening to my lecture, I have to tell you very clearly that if you do not have this concept that the diaphragm is going to be intact, you cannot remove this tumor. There is no need for transcranial surgery in this. You can remove this tumor in quick time and in very effective manner. This is another tumor I removed by just opening the anterior wall of the cella, demolished the tumor, learned the art of breaking the tumor, break the tumor, and you get the whole tumor in beautiful fashion. Tumor involving the cavernous sinus, you have to know that the lateral wall will be intact. Sixth nerve will be more often displaced on the inferior surface of the tumor. And you have to know these tumors beautifully. And you have to know how to extend your exposure towards the cavernous sinus. And when you do not remove this elevation, you see the elevation of the roof of the cavernous sinus. If you do not know how to remove this, then you will have to give radiation because when the tumor elevates the roof of cavernous sinus, they are more aggressive tumor. But if you have the concept that there is going to be dura, but you have to understand the third nerve will be displaced on the dome of the tumor. The dura protects the third nerve. You have to have that understanding and you can remove this tumor beautifully. When the tumor encases the arteries of Circle of Willis, then there is an issue and then you have to decide how to operate, whether to operate radically or whether to give radiation for these tumors. Another tumor is benign tumor of trigeminal schwannoma. Trigeminal schwannoma is a fantastic tumor. This article I wrote in 2003 where I mentioned for the first time in the literature that these tumors arise from the Meckel cave. This was the largest series at that time. Now my series is more than 300 cases, which is also the largest series. So we said that this tumor arises from the Meckel cave. It opens the dura. It remains within the dura. It elevates the dura, it does not go into the cavernous sinus. It does not involve or encase the carotid artery. If you respect the dura, you can remove this tumor in the region of cavernous sinus. In 2003, I had said that this part of the tumor is subarachnoid, but now I say very clearly and without any doubt that many of these cases, there can be dural presence even in this part of the tumor. So dura, respect the dura, learn the art of demolishing the tumor, and you can do a very beautiful resection. In 1995, 26 years ago, I described this approach, interdural approach of trigeminal neuroma without craniotomy. You can remember, imagine 25, 26 years ago, tumors in the region of cavernous sinus were very difficult to remove. Many, even now it is not so easy. So we remove these tumors by just widening the foramen ovale and doing zygomatic osteotomy and coming in this direction, infratemporal, interdural, by understanding the dura. So we remove this trigeminal neuroma without craniotomy by just opening the foramen ovale. Another case I did in 1994, you see this tumor going in the posterior fossa, involving the cavernous sinus, not inside. Inside the dural membrane. So I just did this craniotomy and I removed this tumor in the posterior cranial fossa by working interdural without craniotomy. In 1994, such tumors were very difficult to operate. This is another tumor I operated during the same time by an extracranial interdural approach. And you see, I have removed this tumor. So understand the tumor. Understand that there is a dural cover. Carotid artery is not encased by the tumor. Trigeminal schwannomas are soft tumors. You break the tumor, break the tumor. Learn the art of protecting the dura and learn the art of removing the tumor without coagulation or very minimum coagulation. You have to break the tumor and then save the fifth nerve. So we describe for the first time as a series that you can improve the sensations of the fifth nerve. In 1991, these tumors were removed in two stages. You see, first this tumor was removed, cavernous sinus part was removed by me in 1991 in two stages. This was another tumor I removed in 1992 in two stages. Larger tumor removed, cavernous sinus removed later. But of course, now there is no question we remove these tumors in single stage. Large tumors, I like to do subtemporal, intradural, and then interdural approach. So this was my craniotomy, which I used to do earlier. Of course, now I don't do such, you see, removal of root of zygoma, roof of condyle, roof of external canal, partial mastectomy. I used to do earlier for these kind of tumors. Now, of course, I do very minimum exposure. This is my current exposure, splitting of the temporalis muscle, do a small craniotomy, and then work around the tumor. So understanding that these tumors are within the dura. Come here, open the dura, work within the dura, soft tumor, demolish the tumor, break the tumor, save the fifth nerve. You don't have to dissect the sixth nerve. You don't have to dissect the third nerve because they have separate dura. Break the tumor, and stay within the tumor. Majority of cases, posterior postapone component also will be in the dura. But if not, then work under the subarachnoid space. Save the fifth nerve, and you have to improve the sensations of the fifth nerve. So we have got a very beautiful experience on trigeminal neuroma, how to resect. This is one of the most beautiful chapters of skull-based surgery. And I have to say that these tumors should not be removed more than 40 minutes or 50 minutes. If you work on this tumor for 20 hours, then it is a wrong operation. Break the tumor, demolish the tumor, respect the membrane. You see, even when there is a small nubbin like this, it is not intracavernous. There is dura here. You see, these are soft tumors, and you can remove these tumors beautifully. And these tumors erode the anterior clinoid, erode the posterior petrous bone. You don't have to do any petrosectomy or anything. Work within the dura, work and respect mother dura. Even when the tumor goes extracranial, there is dura remains here. You see, I wrote this article in 2010 where I said that tumors where it goes extracranial, the dura remains intact. And you work from the cranium, you know, it is transcranial or reverse skull base approach. open, do a small temporal craniotomy and work within the dura, and you can do, this is V1 along the V2, along the V3, and even the extracranial part of the tumor respects the dura. Even when the tumor is apoplectic recurrence, it respects the dura. So this mother dura has to be understood. Now I show you third nerve tumor. This is a tumor which patient comes with third nerve palsy. When the patient comes with selective third nerve palsy, it is third nerve neurinoma. You must know that the third nerve neurinoma respects the dura. And you see these tumors arise in the region, like acoustic arise in the internal auditory meatus, like trigeminal neurinoma arises in the Meckel's cave, oculomotor neurinoma arises in the oculomotor cistern here, and then it elevates the dura. You see this tumor has been removed and the eye movements are intact. So if you want to save the eye movements, you have to work within the dura, demolish the tumor, saving all the fibers of the third nerve. And that is if you remove the capsule of the tumor, which is not the tumor, it is dura. So third nerve tumors are very beautiful tumors to operate. And you see there is dura intact all around the third nerve. Work within the tumor, work within the tumor, and you can remove these tumors beautifully. Sixth nerve tumor. Sixth nerve schwannoma can encase the carotid artery. I am working on the strategy of these tumors, but these are a little bit different tumors. Now I want to show you seventh nerve neurinoma, subtemporal interdural approach. If you see this tumor, don't get scared about this tumor. This is a seventh nerve neurinoma. It will present with dense seventh nerve palsy. Come from here. See this soft necrotic tumor. Work within the dura. Try to save the where the seventh nerve course, try to save and avoid working, and you can save the seventh nerve function or improve the seventh nerve function. I'm saying you can. I'm not saying I have. So if you want to improve the seventh nerve function, work within the dura, and you can see this interdural approach for seventh nerve neurinoma. And I can tell you, these tumors can be removed in quick time. This tumor can be removed in half an hour or 40 minutes. But if you do not understand the dural configuration of these tumors, you cannot remove this. There is no way you can remove. Lower cranial nerve neurinoma. You see lower cranial nerve neurinoma, you see my article, interdural approach. Interdural approach, if you know how to do within the dura, you can certainly improve the lower cranial nerve function. You see, if you read this article of mine, you will see that I have improved the lower cranial nerve function in 100% of cases. So this tumor arises. Now you see this tumor arises in the petrous bone, in the region of jugular foramen. It does not arise intracranial, does not arise extracranial. It remains within the dura. So what you have to do is, you have to do this petrosectomy, open the dura, work within the dura, work within the dura. Even the extracranial part of the tumor is within the dura, and you retain this dura intracranially, extracranially, and in the petrous bone. Don't try to expose anything outside the dura. If you have that concept, you can certainly improve the function. You see this huge tumor, and if you see the whole dura is completely not resected. If you try to remove the dura, you will certainly, no question, you will certainly damage the lower cranial nerves without any question. I want to show you another tumor, C2 neurinoma. I told you that trigeminal neurinoma arises. This is trigeminal nerve. This is the largest gasserine ganglion, is the largest ganglion in the cranium cavity. C2 ganglion is the largest ganglion in the spine. C2 ganglion is located behind the atlantoaxial joint. C2 neurinomas arise within the C2 ganglion and they remain intradural. Intradural, such a great concept. So when I described initially, I said like trigeminal neurinoma, I said this part is intradural. Similarly, we had said that this part of the tumor is intradural and this part of the tumor is intradural. This is what we had said. So this article in 2008, I had studied where I said that this part of the tumor is intradural. In 2018, I produced another series of 50 cases where I said that this part of the tumor is always interdural. So if you have this concept that the vertebral artery will be displaced, the venous plexus in the vertebra will be displaced, you can do a quick dissection of this tumor by working within the dura. And I can tell you that many of these tumors can be removed in half an hour or 20 minutes. If you understand this tumor, you see, you think that it is going inside and all those things, but there is dura which is present. Dura which is present, vertebral artery is displaced, like trigeminal neuroma, dura is present, dura is present, dura is present. Work within the dura, work within the dura, work within the dura, and you can remove this tumor beautifully. So C2 neuronomas are like trigeminal schwannomas. Here, trigeminal nerve is very, very important, but C2 nerve is not so important. It will produce some numbness. So you can sacrifice the C2 nerve if at all, but you can even save the C2 nerve if you work within the dura, if you know how to remove the tumor without coagulation. If you coagulate, you can never save any cranial nerve. So you have to know how to break the tumor, how to demolish the tumor. Now I want to show you another fantastic skull-based tumor, chordoma, clival chordoma. Clival chordoma arise within the bone. They destroy the bone, but they displace the soft tissue. They displace the dura. You see, the dura is displaced. Carotid artery is displaced anteriorly. The trigeminal nerves are displaced rostrally. So if you work from this aspect, from the lateral perspective, you see the carotid artery is displaced anteriorly. The dura is displaced. So if you work from lateral perspective, you can remove this trigeminal schwannomas beautifully. And I described this middle fossa subgasserian and ganglion approach to clival chordoma. This tumor, if you know carotid arteries, anterior, dura is posterior, you can do a quick dissection and you can do a very beautiful resection. So lateral transcranial route is a beautiful route for these tumors. And if you know, these tumors are one of the beauties. Of course, many of these tumors can be removed by transnasal route, endoscopy and all those things. But transcranial is a beautiful route where you can do all the dissection under direct vision. So that is the importance of transcranial route where you are doing this dissection. We also describe supracerebellar approach to clival chordoma. Like this kind of clival come from lateral supracerebellar. You see, that is the way to expose the sixth nerve early in the operation and save the sixth nerve early in the operation, and then come in this direction and you can remove this tumor. Of course, I will not do many of these tumors can be removed and should be removed from lateral, and some of these tumors can be removed from nasal, but supracerebellar approach is also a possibility in some of these tumors. This was a clival chordoma. I removed this tumor from a supracerebellar route in a beautiful fashion. You see, this kind of huge tumor, if you want to save the sixth nerve, if you are coming from nasal, of course you can remove this tumor, but you never know where is the sixth nerve. You know, don't know how to save the sixth nerve. So I had removed some time ago this tumor from a supracerebellar route. So we have to know these are extracranial tumors. Nasal tumors, they respect the dura, they respect the carotid artery. So we have to know which tumor is what. So these are very vascular nasopharyngeal angiofibromas. They are not only extradural, but they are extracranial, and you have to remove this tumor. I had described transcranial route to remove this tumor, but no way, you have to remove this tumor by mid-facial degloving route and developing a plane of dissection from the tumor, from the basal dura. So these are epidermoid tumors. They have inconsistent relationship with the dura. These are aspergillomas. These are tuberculomas. So there are many kinds of tumors involving the cavernous sinus. Briefly, I want to talk about cavernous meningiomas. Like you see some tumors, convexity tumors, which go into the superior serrated sinus, like this one. This is going into the superior serrated sinus. So these tumors are inherently more aggressive than a convexity tumor. When they go into the nasal sinuses, they are more aggressive inherently. When they are inside the paranasal sinuses, they are certainly more aggressive or malignant tumors. Similarly, cavernous sinus tumor when the tumor is inside the cavernous sinus is inherently more aggressive when it is inside the dura, outside the dura. So these tumors are difficult tumors. When they remain only outside the cavernous sinus, they are very benign. When they go inside the cavernous sinus and outside, they are more aggressive. When they go inside the paranasal sinuses, they become malignant. So inside the cavernous sinus tumor, I resected and you see the recurrence. So the tumors which are completely inside the cavernous sinus are more prone for recurrence. This is another meningioma I had done and there was a recurrence. Tumors which go into the paranasal sinuses are more aggressive. So these tumors which are outside the cavernous sinus are benign. This tumor arising from the posterior wall of the cavernous sinus, benign. This tumor arising from the posterior wall of the cavernous sinus beautifully can be removed. These are much less aggressive. This is tumor coming from lateral wall of the cavernous sinus. Beautifully, it can be removed. Learn the art of breaking the tumor. I used to do very extensive vitrectomy earlier in my life. This is 94, 95, where I used to mobilize the facial nerve, cutting GSPN and mobilizing for petroclival tumors. But now my exposure is much less for majority of tumor. And I describe lateral supracerebellar approach for petroclival tumors for the first time in the literature. And this approach has now become very popular. And I have done several cases of this type with supracerebellar approach. As you can see, supracerebellar approach for these tumors is supracerebellar. Understand the art of breaking the tumor, demolish the tumor, minimum coagulation. You can go into the trigeminal gastrin ganglion, into the cavernous sinus, and you can remove these tumors beautifully. You see, no question, there is no need to do much vitrectomy in majority of these petroclival meningiomas. And this is one tumor. There's a small video. I don't want to show you too much, but just see the last part of the operation. And this is another tumor. Just see the last part of the operation. I cannot show you much because of the time constraint. This is the post at the end of the operation. This is supracerebellar approach, you see, and I can show you the last part of the operation, the basilar artery and all those things from a supracerebellar. This is a beautiful approach for many of these petroclival meningiomas. I have also got the largest experience in the world in tuberculum cellular meningioma. I reported 70 cases in 2002. Now my experience is 300 cases. Olfactory group, this is personal experience of 129 cases, also the largest. So essentially my public hospital gives me a very beautiful opportunity to do many of these tumors. As regards meningioma, we have to remove them carefully. We have to remove them radically. But we must know that we cannot cure these tumors. This beautiful sentence I want you to take home is, recurrence of a meningioma is independent of the extent of tumor resection. We have to be radical, but we don't have to be. Our crusade has to be careful, philosophical. We have to understand that it is not the treatment, but cellular behavior decides the outcome of a meningioma. So thank you very much, my dear friends. I hope I have given you some thoughts on how these tumors behave and how we have to resect the tumor, how we have to understand the dura, how we have to respect the membranes. We have to have more and more experience in breaking the tumor. We have to have more experience in controlling bleeding. Controlling bleeding is our wealth, how we control blood, how we control bleeding in cavernous sinus, how we control bleeding in petroclival tumors in cavernous sinus, how we control bleeding in arteriovenous malformation surgery determines how we can be successful and how we can come out of that difficult problem. So it is complex, it is difficult, but it can be become reasonably good and very straightforward. My concept is majority of the tumors in the brain should be removed in 1 hour or 1.5 hours. If you understand these tumors, if you know how to local anatomy, if you understand how to protect the nerves, how to save the vessels and how do not become too aggressive, you can give new life to these patients. So that is my lesson. Lesson is learn anatomy. Learn anatomy of the tumors. Have experience in demolishing these pituitary tumors, meningioma, choriomas, and all these tumors are complex, but they are our life. We have to enjoy them, we have to learn them, and we have to demolish them. Thank you very much, my dear friends.
Thank you very much for such a wonderful lecture, Dr. Goel. It was outstanding. Really. I'm sure all the audience surely has learned a lot from this. You mentioned something about limit coagulation inside the tumor and instead of that, breaking it. But what do you think about the use of hemostatic agents for bleeding control of cavernous sinus?
See, there is a tumor like acoustic tumor. My concept is coagulating inside the acoustic tumor is waste of time. Coagulating outside the tumor is a technical error. So there is a need for coagulation in acoustic tumor. But if you continuously go on coagulating, you will not be able to remove a large acoustic tumor. That is my firm concept. And hemostatic agents, some people introduce some gel or some kind of, you know, when to use gel foam, when to use Surgicel, when to use bipolar, when to use bone wax, when to use pressure, when to ignore. That is our learning. That is our life. That is our life of neurosurgery. And we have to learn all those things, when to use what and how to use what kind of coagulation. I don't believe in any kind of external agents like, you know, like Tisil and all those things. I don't use, I don't recommend. I think that is just a waste of time.
Okay. We have some questions from the public. James Dowling asks, at this time, what type of tumor would you consider inoperable?
That is a very difficult question. And I wish that there is no tumor which is not operable. I wish. But we are human beings, we have to understand. And if some tumor is beyond the scope, I have a feeling that there should be not be any tumor which is not inoperable. I gave one lecture some years ago, surgery on impossible brain tumors. So you make that situation of impossible possible. You make yourself so strong that you should make the impossible look easy. Complex looks easy. Difficult looks simple. So that is our training in neurosurgery. There can be some tumor which can be impossible, but you know, to tell you like that is a little bit difficult to answer that question.
Yes, surely it is. Here's another question. What do you think is the role of preoperative embolization in the management of complex brain tumors?
You see, preoperative embolization, I don't think it is necessary. I think preoperative embolization is necessary on two occasions. One is for sometimes for glomus tumors, and sometimes for nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. Sometimes, I'm not saying always. I have seen very serious complication in nasopharyngeal angiofibroma embolization. I completely do not recommend embolization for nasopharyngeal angiofibroma finally. I sometimes recommend for glomus tumors. Other than that, I do not even recommend preoperative embolization for arteriovenous malformation surgery, where I have got a very beautiful experience on AVM surgery. I think preoperative embolization should not be done. That is my answer.
Okay, Professor, thank you. And finally, you mentioned the importance of, you know, like knowing anatomy. So what anatomical models do you suggest to improve tumor resection techniques in young neurosurgeons?
See, young neurosurgeons, when they are operating, they are not allowed to create a complication. Even old neurosurgeon or a senior neurosurgeon, when he is operating, he is not allowed to create a complication. So I cannot say that young neurosurgeon and old neurosurgeon, because every neurosurgeon for the patient is the same. Whether you are young or whether you are old, you have to be good. So you have to learn quickly and become senior and strong. Of course, you have to learn on the patients. You have to learn on the human body. You have to learn the art of breaking the tumor, learn the art of understanding the anatomy. Abnormal anatomy, when there is tumor, the anatomy is different. When there is normal anatomy, the anatomy is different. So you have to go to the anatomy lab. You have to think about the tumor. You have to think about the dura. You have to think about the vascularity. You have to think about the location of the artery. You have to think about the location of the nerve, and you have to protect that nerve. You have to remember that one small mistake can kill the person. One perforator in a petroclival meningioma you take, you create hemiplegia. One small perforator in a basilar artery you take, you kill the person. So you're not allowed to make one mistake. You cannot say, I am a young neurosurgeon, so I am allowed to make a mistake. You're not allowed to make a mistake, a young or old. We must know that we are operating on a human body. So you have to have that confidence, even if you are young. So I can say that you can have more confidence. You can have overconfidence, but not underconfidence. So when you are operating as a young neurosurgeon, you have to go with good confidence, with strong etiquette and strong, powerful etiquette to operate on any kind of problem. So you should not say, I'm young, so I made a mistake. You cannot do that.
Thank you, Professor. On behalf of the CIEN, I would like to thank you again, Dr. Goel. It has been a wonderful lecture. We are really grateful and honored of your participation on the 2021 IWBNC. More than 200 people were connected to your conference from over more than 50 different countries. Remember, Professor, you are welcome to the CIEN anytime you want, and we hope some of us could visit you as well. You are more than welcome to stay tuned to watch more lectures of other speakers. Dr. Goel, we hope to continue in touch with you. Have a great day.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So I can stay on the same channel, same line?
Yes. Well, in the website of the CIEN, there's the links, or in the chat right now, of the next lecture. That is in a few minutes. We will have Dr. Adelson doing his lecture, Epilepsy Surgery in Children, Innovations in Diagnosis and Treatment. To get the link for this upcoming conference, please follow the link pinned on the chat screen or check the agenda at our website, that is cienhos.com.
Thank you very much, and bye-bye to all of you. And I hope you have enjoyed it. And I hope I could give some beautiful messages about pituitary tumor, about trigeminal neuroadenomas, about hemangiomas, about chordomas, about lower cranial nerve neuroadenomas, about oculomotor neuroadenomas, about various tumors. So thank you very much, and bye-bye to all of you.
Thank you, Dr. Goel.